Mehmet Fatih. He's an astronautical engineer, graduated from University of Turkish Aeronautics in 2019. He's doing his master's in aeronautical and astronautical engineering in Istanbul Technical University. His main interests are orbit determination and he's developing an educational kit for high school about the physics, and he's also building a ground station, a radio RASAT, radio antenna satellite project. And he's the founder and team leader of the Satnok stations on the UTAA. That was the University of Turkey's Aeronautical Association. And yeah, he's working on a Doppler-based orbit determination with optimization. How you can determine the orbit of a satellite with just hearing it, which is really interesting. There are a lot of people working on that on the Satmex team. And well, apparently Mehmet is also working on that, and they should talk to each other.
Okay.
Mehmet,
Yes,
you've
thank you very
got the
much.
screen.
Thank you very much for introduction. I'm directly starting my presentation in 10 minutes. It will be a little fast and maybe technical presentation. This study made in collaboration with some students and professors from the University of Turkish Aeronautical Association and published as a conference proceeding. Actually, after the installing our Satmax ground station, we asked why we don't use our own data to make an orbit determination. Then the study starts with aiming to make an orbit determination without having any information about the satellite. In other words, we just heard the satellite and wanted to determine it. Today I'm going to have an introduction about following steps. The details of the study will be presented as time allows. Lastly, I will show some preliminary results of the study. There are different orbit determination methods, as we all know, and different required data for them. These data are mainly optical based or radio based. In general, obtaining the data is in the control of some governments or militaries. There are also some commercial companies like LeoLabs. You can see one of their antennas in the right side. On the other hand, some civilian based platforms also try to contribute space situational awareness. Actually, we do not have raw data in Satnok, however, in principle, each station in the Satnok can generate its own Doppler data. We also used a Satnok station, as I said in the beginning. The UTA station generally seems offline, actually, due to a network problem at the university. I hope this will be solved in the coming weeks. However, we have a bunch of antennas there, and we used them in this study. The voice of the Sputnik means a lot for Guy and Weifenbach. They discovered the potential of the Doppler effect to determine orbit of a satellite after hearing that voice. It was very beginning of the space era with launch of Sputnik in 1957. This table from their first paper, and they searched for orbits of Sputnik 1 and Explorer 1 in this paper. Actually, the story of their discovery is so interesting, but I do not give the details due to time limits. I may just suggest you to give a look at Gagagan's book, which is written in here. Doppler shift is a fundamental phenomenon for the waves, as we all know. It causes a shift on the transmitted frequency. That shift always decreases observed. That shift always decreases observed frequency during pass, as you can see in here. You can see a frequency time graph of a satellite pass. Observed frequency is bigger than the transmitted frequency in the beginning of the pass, and it is decreasing during the pass. Also, the maximum elevation angle of the pass affects the shape of the graph, as you can see in here. In here, there's 20 degree maximum elevation pass and 40 and 80 degree maximum elevation pass can be seen in this graph. In this page, you can see the flow chart of our study. Firstly, obtaining a reference data is needed. That can be artificial or real data. We use artificial data to establish our method in a setting without observation errors. However, we also made some tests with the real data. To obtain artificial data, we propagate the closest TLE and generate range rate data. That decreases our computation time, and that was needed for us. In real data case, we made a few observations, but signals have some incoherency, which will be discussed later. Also, obtaining data from the real observation is not easy for us. In the beginning, we tried to use STRF to get frequency time data. However, the given frequency of the STRF and the frequency on the screen of the STR sharp is different for the same time. We do not know the reason of that difference, so we decided to obtain data manually from the screen of STR sharp, and that was a hard process, so that affected our satellite selection criteria for the real data. After obtaining real or artificial data, we started the optimization process. First, boundaries and constraints should be defined. However, as I said in the beginning, there is an uninformed situation about the satellite. So we just assume a low Earth orbit satellite with 200 kilometers to 2,000 kilometers altitude. That gives natural boundaries for 7 major axes to decrease search space. Also, circular and elliptical cases are searched separately. In here, we try to minimize RMS value, which is calculated with the reference RODOT and calculated RODOT during the pass. Then we start a genetic optimization to have preliminary results. In this study, particle swarm optimization PSO is used. The results of the PSO are not so accurate actually. However, they are accurate enough to be an initial condition of a gradient-based optimization. This two-phased optimization process gave a nice prediction about the orbit, especially if you thought there is no information about the orbit in the beginning. The results are fairly good for circular orbits. This process repeated 200 times and the best results taken from there. After that, we hope to improve our accuracy with differential correction. In here, we use Viados algorithm directly. It worked for some cases. I will talk about them. Finally, we hope to make some fine tunings on the process and having some more tests with actually real data in this year. After these improvements, we hope to have a repository for the work. Any kind of collaboration or comments will be great for us. This is the process of generating artificial data, as I mentioned. We use two-body propagator to simplify calculations and to reduce computation time. These are constraints for the circular and elliptical cases. You may add a prograde or retrograde assumption if you want. This is not mandatory actually, because if you do not make an assumption in here, you can find plus or minus 90 degree difference between your result and correct one. That assumption does not affect the accuracy of the other results actually. And for the elliptic cases, we may increase the our search space for the depending on the satellite, but for the low Earth case, these numbers are valid. This is the basic representation of the particle swarm optimization actually. Adding some mutation or other techniques to avoid local minimum points increases the accuracy of PSO. However, it may cause an increment for the computation time, and you can see the RMS calculation in here, as I stated before. The differential correction process is exactly the same with Viados book, as I stated, so that I will not talk about it. You can find algorithm in the book. This table is the results of the ISS with artificial data. The first line is our reference data. Then you can see the PSO results with absolute errors in the green lines. There's a 20 degree error at the most, but when we use differential correction for these results, blue lines appear and our accuracy increases to 3 degree for angular elements and 20 kilometer for semi-major axis. I think this improvement really impressive for the differential for the PSO, say. But more impressive results come from the gradient based optimization. In here, accuracy of the angular elements increases roughly 1 degree accuracy. Also, accuracy of the semi-major axis becomes lower than 1 kilometer, as you can see in here. However, differential correction didn't work didn't work for that results. Most probably we have an implementation error in the our codes for the gradient results. If we can for the application of the differential correction on the gradient results, if we can run it correctly, most likely results will be so accurate. This table is again the same results with the gradient based optimization. You can see state vectors in here. In terms of magnitudes, 1 kilometer accuracy for position and 1 meter per second accuracy for velocity achieved. If you look deeper with three axis, the biggest error for position is in the z direction, and its reason is the magnitude of the z velocity. Actually, it's the biggest one, and the error is bigger in here actually. In this page, you can see results of two more satellites, which is NOAA-19 and Express-MD2. The aim of this page actually is just showing that the increasing on the ellipticity of the orbit decreases the accuracy. However, we can start to calculate or predict the eccentricity with that way. And this is our test case for the real data. The Gurwin TechSat 1B is selected because it was the only satellite which is periodically beeping for each 30 seconds on the observation day. We had also some other satellite signals with CV beacons. However, their frequency time data has some frequent oscillations. They just go like that, and we couldn't be sure actually. 2 minutes, okay. This is another interesting graph for us. The blue line is the artificial data for GO32, which is propagated from the closest TLA. The red line is the observation data. There is a 2 kHz difference in the between the artificial and real data in the beginning of the pass. However, this difference decreases below to 1 kHz in the end of the pass. This is unexpected for us, and there might be some possibilities for that, but we do not know the exact reason. This variable difference has bad effects on our results. The yellow graph is our optimization graph, actually. You can see the Keplerian elements for this pass. The reason of the low RMS in here is having less data point. There should be 20 or 30 data points. Accuracy is not so good, as you can see, but enough to make a rough guess about the orbit. Also, the most remarkable result is in inclination. It just dropped the lower bound of the optimization boundaries. All of these results show us that dealing with real data is not easy as artificial data. Finally, we see that usage of the gradient optimization with genetic optimization can give accurate results according to an uninformed situation about satellite. And also circularity of the orbit increases accuracy. As a future work, we need to try different propagation methods to improve accuracy. More tests with real data is needed. Especially the process of obtaining Doppler data from an observation should be improved for us. Multi-station or multi-pass situation can be searched for the possibilities of more accurate results. Finally, after these improvements, we hope to start to preparing the repository. We are open for any collaboration during all of these process. Lastly, these are the references of the study. And thank you for listening to me. I hope at least I can make a rough picture about the study. Any kind of question or comments will be great for us. In addition, you can contact me with my email address, which is written in the below. Lastly, I want to thank the organization committee to make this event online and give a chance to us to participate here.
Awesome. It's a very interesting concept, and it's really interesting because for us, during ELIOP, the early phases after launch, we use the same tools like STRI and SAT tools to get the first TLEs of some objects. And for us, it's very crucial and very important to have good TLEs on SatNets in order to allow for the community to get data. So we totally have to work together and figure out means and ways to collaborate further to see how we can optimize our data and stuff like that. And well, but you have some questions from the crowd. First and foremost, Fernando, how's the sender frequency is estimated?
Central frequency, actually in this study, in the beginning of the study, we do not think optimization can found central frequency and give the central frequency to the optimization as a known quantity. And these results are in these results, the central frequency is known. But after the conference, we try to give the optimization process. We try to give central frequency to the optimization process, and we saw that central frequency can be found in the optimization process too. The error in the central frequency in plus minus 2 kHz or something like that, but the accuracy of the Keplerian elements didn't decrease with giving without knowing the central frequency actually. That was interesting, I think.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Fabian asks where he can find the orbit determination code that you presented. Oh, he's also online. He can ask it for himself.
Actually, you can contact with me. That we do not have any repository yet because the codes and process, all of the process are just in draft modes. But we can share all of the algorithm clearly. We do not have any repository for yet because, as I said, the project didn't finish yet. We hope in the future we will.
Did you already decide on a license? May I ask a follow-up? Did you already decide on which license you will use for this? Because this is really important if you want to go public and call something open source. Then
we didn't decide actually. Just we are, our main focus is just doing it. can we see, can we find how can we be accurate? We want to see first that, then we thought about the repository parts.
My personal suggestion, if you like to have it, is that release anything you got, even if you are not 100% sure it's optimized perfectly, because then the global community will work with it. For example, Elias, the person that's gonna speak after you, thinks that this optimization process might be really interesting, not only for SatNox, but for our upcoming satellite. So that would be extra cool if you did. Boris Agrev asked, is there intent to locate non-cooperative satellites independently? Like when TLEs are not by NOAA, I will remind Boris that TLEs are not provided by NOAA, they are provided right now by NORAD.
Actually, I'm sorry. Yeah. Okay.
18th space squadron something, and what are the possible uses? Mehmet?
Actually, I missed some part of the question due to.
Okay, I try to tell it with other words. So this orbit determination is interesting from the ground for satellites when you don't have the TLE.
Yeah.
Okay. So what is the intent behind that? To locate satellites, unknown satellites, or to make some other uses of that? So what's the idea behind? And after, I'd like to comment on to complement on LF's suggestions just before, but. What are the uses you have in mind?
I couldn't hear the last word, actually. Sorry.
Okay. Is my audio...
What kind of Yeah.
Is my audio correct, or do I need to?
Yeah, your audio is cool.
It's okay. About.
So why do you want to locate satellites?
Why do I locate satellites?
Yeah.
Sorry, I couldn't understand the question correctly.
Okay. Well, I think the community can find some use for that.
I would like to point out that TLEs are not updated as often as it would be. Because there are limits to the hardware, the hardware used by NORAD to generate them, and they have to generate them that often. And having verified series of objects that are in orbit allows us to track them more efficiently. It's regularly done when we have a TLE that is publicly available. And Elias, that will speak right now, has some very interesting